As we read through today's passage, many of you no doubt noticed that we read what is probably the most famous verse in all the Bible, both within the church and outside the church as well, John 3:16. And it's a verse that quite a few people, even outside the church, do know. If not the actual words, they know the reference. The famousness of the verse will show us just how incredibly important and weighty and powerful these words are. But if we're being honest, if you're anything like me, John 3:16 doesn't strike you that way anymore. Right? Unfortunately, when we hear John 3:16, what triggers in our minds is more the feeling of a nursery rhyme than world-changing truth. It's something we learned a long time ago, maybe in preschool, we memorized it and we moved beyond it. Why is that? Why, when so clearly, when the world recognizes that there's something so weighty about these, are we not recognizing something here? What are we not seeing that we perhaps saw once long ago? So to help answer that question, I want to begin by bringing your attention to one word in John 3:16, and it's probably not the word that you're suspecting. It's not loved or eternal or life. It's the word so. Sometime in college, it occurred to me that I understood these words always, for God so loved the world as God loved the world so much. But when we think of the English language, the word so actually has multiple meanings. We also use the word so to say, I think so, or I will do so. And in that sense, so means in a particular way or accordingly, right? So looking into the Greek, I discovered that actually the so in John 3:16 is in this way or accordingly, which means we need to understand this as, for God loved the world in a particular way, which then begs the question, what way did God love the world, in what way? And the answer for that is in the immediately preceding verses, John 14 through 15. Let me read that again. It says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. You notice that the words here are very similar to John 3:16. Clearly there's a connection here. So what is Jesus talking about? He's saying, everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. But before that, he says, just as Moses lifted up the bronze snake, he too will be lifted up. We just read the Old Testament passage where the Israelites, who rebelled so sinfully against God, were bitten by venomous snakes. But when they saw the bronze snake, they didn't die. And Jesus compares himself to the snake. And he says, just as the snake was lifted up, he too will be lifted up. And there is a clear double meaning here. When we say lifted up, clearly, one thing it could mean is that God is being lifted up, he's being exalted, Jesus is being exalted and glorified. But the other meaning is quite literally, he's being lifted up. Just as the bronze snake was lifted up by Moses, Jesus himself will be lifted up. And when was he lifted up? He was lifted up when he was on the cross. So coming back, putting all this together, when we say, for God loved the world in a particular way, we're seeing that what Jesus is saying is God loved the world in this way by putting me on the cross. And we have to pause here. I want to make something that's seemingly obvious a little bit clearer because I think it's important. God is saying God loved the world by allowing his son to die on the cross. Now, let's say I love my friend Jared. You all have people that you love. Do you typically show love to a person by going and getting yourself killed? That's not an immediate logical connection, right? Typically, if I did that, Jared, my friend, might actually take it the opposite way. So it might backfire in the most horrible of ways. Why is him getting killed a sign of love for me? The only situation in which that is an act of love is if for some reason Jared got himself into a situation where he himself was about to die and I decided to take his place. So when we say that God loved the world by giving Jesus to die on the cross, we're saying something about our own situation. For us, the stakes were, they are, and they always have been life and death. And what I want to venture to say to you today is that perhaps the reason why John 3:16 doesn't strike us the way that it used to, or if we've never been struck by it, it's because we've never understood the stakes that Jesus is talking about. The stakes have always been life and death. Do we understand the stakes? I can tell you who clearly understood the stakes of life and death, and that were the Israelites in the desert who were bit by the venomous snakes. Because see, for them, when Moses put up that bronze snake, they weren't thinking, oh, that's really kind of Moses to do. They were thinking, I need to see that snake or I'm going to die. Every fiber in their being was burning with the poison that was going through the system. They knew they would die. Every cell in their body was screaming, I'm going to die unless I see that snake. And if Jesus compares himself with the bronze snake, who should we be comparing ourselves with? Clearly, it's the Israelites who were on fire from the venom inside of them, about to die. The stakes were that for them was life and death, and the stakes for us also is life and death. One of my most favorite apologists, Ravi Zacharias, once said in one of his messages, and some people think he got it from C.S. Lewis, but he said, Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. Jesus came to make dead people live. There's a Steven Spielberg movie called Catch Me If You Can. I think many of you probably might have seen it. It's a great movie. But it's based on the life of a real-life young man named Frank Abagnale, who in the 60s lived a life of crime by forging checks and impersonating other people. And he was so good at this that he ended up stealing millions of dollars. And throughout the movie, there is an FBI agent named Carl who's running after Frank. He's trying to catch him. And eventually, by the end of the movie, Carl catches up to Frank in France in a printing press. And he comes into this building and they're all alone. And Carl says to Frank, Frank, outside right now are 24 French police officers who want to bring you in. I told them I would only help them if they let me be the one to cuff you. And Frank looks at Carl and says, it's Christmas Eve, Carl. You're bluffing. I don't believe you. And he grabs an armful of forged checks and he's about to sprint out the door when Carl yells out to Frank, they're going to kill you. And Frank freezes. And it's like in that moment, all of a sudden, Frank realizes what the stakes have become. In the beginning of his life of crime, the stakes were simply freedom or jail. But at some point, he crossed the line, and those weren't the stakes anymore. The stakes now were life and death. And Frank turns to Carl, and he asks him a really peculiar question. He says, Carl, do you have any children? And Carl says, yeah, I have a 4-year-old daughter. And Frank says, do you swear on the life of your daughter that you're telling the truth? And Carl says, yes. And Frank drops the forged checks and he surrenders himself to Carl. They walk out, turns out Carl was telling the truth. But does anything about this picture resonate with you? I don't know where you are with the Lord, but what I find so interesting about this movie is that throughout the entire movie, Carl's the one chasing after Frank, but the one who's been chasing after Frank the entire time, when he finally catches up with him, is the one to save his life. And for you, do you feel like in some area of your life, you're just running and running because you feel like God is the one who's after you, and when he catches up with you, it's jail or something much worse than that. But could it possibly be that when he does catch up with you, you realize all along he was the only one who could have saved you? And the other interesting thing is, Carl swears on the life of his 4-year-old daughter, but our Heavenly Father did something far greater than that. He didn't just swear on the life of his son, he gave up his son so that we might have life. So today, the question I want to ask you to reflect on in our time of reflection is, do I understand the stakes? Do I understand that the stakes all along have been life and death? And do I understand that the one who's been chasing after me all along has not been chasing after me to condemn me, but to offer me life? Let's enter into a time of reflection.